is possible. Whether you're here with us in person, in the sanctuary, or at the pavilion, or whether you're with us online, mahalo for joining us this morning. Before we get started, I wanted to share with you a scripture from 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9. It says, that is what the scriptures mean when they say, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. But it was to us that God revealed these things by his Spirit. For his Spirit searches out everything and shows us God's deep secrets. No one can know a person's thoughts except that person's own spirit. And no one can know God's thoughts except God's own spirit. And we receive God's spirit, not the world's spirit. So we can know the wonderful things God has freely given us. So church, if you can just help us this morning, we want to invite the Holy Spirit in here. We want to, you know, dwell in his presence. And as you can see, we've removed some of the robes for a cakey dedication later in the service. So if you could just rise and join us in worship.
As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on. Come down.
Come down. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come now. Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me.
Come fill this room.
Spirit was moving.
As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest.
Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us.
Fire
and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us.
Come down.
Come down.
Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you feel the room,
you're here and I know you
are moving.
I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down.
Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room,
you're here
and I know you are moving.
I'm here and I know you will fill me.
Fill the room, heal on us.
Let's call out to him.
Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want.
You're all we want. Oh, oh, oh. You're all we want.
You're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make the heart bound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart bound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. Here and I know you will fill me. Fill me with faith, fill us all.
Nothing more than ever come close.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord,
I've tasted and seen.
Tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord.
Holy Spirit, you're welcome here.
Holy Spirit, you are. Your presence. let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Father, while we sit in your presence, we just want to proclaim your glory, your joy, Lord God.
Light of the world, you step down.
You're all together.
step. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Let this be our prayer to you. Thank you for sending down your presence. Amen.
All right. Thank you so much. So good to see you all this morning. Go ahead and greet a few friends as you take your seat. Say hello to your neighbors. By the way, if you are in middle school or in high school, you're welcome to join the youth group. They're making their way outside to the youth room, so please go ahead, feel free to do that. Here at Grace Honolulu, we like to say that everyone is welcome because no one is perfect, but with God, all things are possible. And I got a chance to see what that actually looks like in real life just yesterday evening. So yesterday evening, our younger son Cole and I, we thought it'd be fun to go and watch the sunset and have a little two-man picnic together. So we did that at Alamoana Beach Park. And it's beautiful. If you've ever had a chance to sit at the park with some family, it's a nice time. And so we weren't, of course, the only family that was there enjoying quality time, enjoying God's beauty, enjoying a little meal. But right next to us, there was another family that came up. And just as the sun was at its most beautiful time, everyone was taking their pictures, and so this family came next to us also, and it was a father and a mother and their three or four kids, and the kids were about teenage age, and they erupted into this big fight, actually, and it was quite a scene, and it was really sad to watch and hear it was happening right next to Cole and me. And everyone was watching, and the son, the 16-year-old or so son, was arguing with the father, and I was just couldn't help but listen to their conversation. And I could tell by what the son was saying that he was just so hurt, because at one point he said something along the lines of, "You've never been a father to me, a father figure to me." So it was that level of a conversation that they were having. And they parted ways, and the family went one way, and the son sat down at the tree right next to Cole and me. It was almost awkward how close he was sitting next to us, kind of just gathering himself, and he was a little teary-eyed, and I felt like that was God prompting me to kind of encourage him somehow. But how do you have the words to step into a situation where you don't really know what to say in such a sensitive time? But I was thinking about how it's so true that everyone's welcome, but no one's perfect, what we say all the time here every single Sunday. And so I just shared with him how, as a parent, and he saw me with our three-year-old son, as a parent, we're never perfect, but we have God's love that is perfect. And I hope that that spoke to him, because he was so let down. I think as a teenage son, you think that your parents are going to be perfect, that they're always going to be there for you, and that's never going to be the case. But I think he needed to hear that there was a God that did have a perfect love for him. So we just prayed together, and I just wanted to encourage you all that all things are possible. That's what we say all the time. So that's why we're all welcome here. We all know that we're not perfect, but we all recognize that God's love is a model for us as parents, is a model for us as family members to each other, as friends. And so that's really the love that we're here to experience and to share with each other. So thanks for letting me share about how I think I've grown through this church, is by learning these lessons and then also being prompted by God to share that. That's the opportunity that we always have every single day, is to share what we've learned here, share God's perfect love with other people. So if you're interested in learning more about how we can just receive from God and God's word, we have a Grace app where you can download all the messages, all of the notes, and go through our archive of material. So go ahead and download the Grace Honolulu app if you have not already. Right now, we're going to receive our tithes and offerings. This is one of the ways that we can just recognize God for his perfect love, for all the things that he's done in our lives. This is just our act of faith and obedience. And so in Leviticus, it says it's a tithe of everything of the land, of the grain. That's what we give back to God because it belongs to him. So that's in Leviticus 27. So it's just with that heart that we give back to God a portion of what we have. It's our act of worship to him. So let's go ahead and pray together as we give back to God. Lord, thank you so much for your perfect love. It heals every single imperfection. It heals every single place where we fall short, Father. So we want to give back to you. We want to honor you as the God of our lives, Father. We do this in your name. Amen.
Woohoo! Good morning, everybody. I love that story that Clifton just told. And these are some of the future world changers and their parents right here. This is an exciting day. Where'd you go? This is an exciting day. We call it Baby D. This is a day where we dedicate children and babies to the Lord. And so we have a lot of family that are here. Yeah, and we got a limited window, too. We got a lot of family that are here, so we are excited that you're here today. But we do believe that raising a family is a partnership with the parents and the church community. And so today we're really excited. We have five children of our own, and we could not have done it without a church community. There's no way.
No, so parents, this is a reminder that you are not in this alone. You have people that are surrounding you to encourage you, support you, helping you not just survive the parenting journey, but actually thrive in it. So you have a church community, you have your small group community, and we're so glad to celebrate this special day with you today. It's an honor for me to introduce the families that are here for Baby Dedication Sunday. We actually have one more family coming in right now. They were, you know, how getting here.
For these parents
is a victory. Just getting here. So first we have Jason and Kelsey Perrin, and they are dedicating their son Kaysen today. We have a picture of Kaysen up there.
Mm.
And then we have Sean and LaDenia Castro, and they are dedicating their daughter Sophia today.
And then I'd like to introduce to you Charnay and Genesis Jima, and they are dedicating, yeah, their two beautiful little girls. That's Ayoka and Yumi. Cute, yeah? And then you said we have somebody else?
They're working their way in,
all right.
And I'll introduce Logan and Teresa Taylor and their sons, Kobe and Vader. Yeah.
This real special day, and the fact that we can be a community is really because of one thing, because we have a Savior, his name is Jesus, who dealt with our biggest need, and he gives meaning to our lives. And so because he died on a cross, rose again, paid the price for our sins, that's why we're here today, and that's why these families are here today, not only expressing their desire to dedicate their children to the Lord. Oh, come on. Anything's possible.
You made it. Woo!
Hey, buddy. How you doing? Good to see you. This is Logan. This is Teresa. This is my man, Kobe. Kobe with a traditional Filipino barong. Beautiful. That's legit. Made of
pineapple
husk or something. Yeah, that is legit. Dude, you look good with that on. And this is little Vader. Little Vader.
The youngest being dedicated. He is 2 weeks old?
Yes.
2 weeks old. So just getting here was, for all of these families, is a miracle, right? Getting here. So So as we dedicate these children today, we're presenting them to our Heavenly Father, and it is a reminder that they belong to God. Children are a gift from God, and they belong to Him. He's entrusted children to families. He's given us a stewardship over their lives. It's an honor, it's a privilege to be able to partner with God in this gift of raising these precious children. Their lives are a precious gift, and when we dedicate them, we're basically saying thank you, God, for giving us these precious gifts.
Yeah, and you know, the thing that gives significance to life, each of these lives and your life, is the fact that we were created by a God who not only loves us, but has a purpose for our lives. And because of His purpose for our lives have incredible significance. So today, as they dedicate their children to the Lord, we are praying for not only their children, but we're praying for them that God would bless them. If those of you are parents, you know we need the blessing of God on our lives, the energy of God on our lives, the strength of God on our lives, the wisdom and the love that God gives to us to be able to give to our children. So praying that God would bless them as they train their children to love Jesus and to discover their purpose.
And we got
to
hurry this along because they 2-year-olds are not going to, they're only going to be so patient with us, right?
But so we're a happy bunch.
We're so excited to be here. So we're going to read one scripture out of Deuteronomy, and it's a charge that I believe God gives to us as we raise our children. He says, "The Lord our God, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. And you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength. And you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commands that I am giving you today. Repeat them again and again to your children.
By talking about them when you're at home, when you're on the road, when you're going to bed, and when you're getting up. Tie them on your hands, wear them on your foreheads as reminders. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates."
So let's pray. Let's pray for these precious gifts that God has given to these families. Lord, we thank you. We thank you that children are a gift from you and that they are precious to you, that all life is precious. And this is just a representative of the wonder and the beauty of your creation, the innocence that you've created for all of us to have this relationship and this wonder with you. So, Lord, we pray for these children. We ask, Father, for you to watch over these children, for your presence to be with these children from a young age, for you to protect them, watch over them, guard them, surround them with angels to oversee them. And, Lord, we pray for you to capture their heart from a really young age, Lord. We thank you.
Yes, and Lord, that you would supply them with the strength as they draw near to you. Lord, we pray that you would strengthen their marriages so they can give beautiful marriages as gifts to their children, Lord, and give them the wisdom and the grace to be the parents that you've created them to be as they trust you, Jesus. We thank you for it in your mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So let's give
Amen.
These parents a hand.
Congratulations. Woo-hoo. You guys are going to follow Miss Chris out. You're welcome. Bye, Sophia. Congratulations. You're welcome, Genesis. All right. That was. Now you got to look at my ugly face for the next. After seeing all that cuteness. There are moments that all of us have in life that just kind of shape us. I want to share with you about a moment that we had some years ago. We have 5 kids. We have kids 10 to 4. And so one Easter, when we lived in Tennessee, we were having an Easter dinner with some friends of ours. It was getting late. There were 2 families that were with us. And as you're going, if you have multiple kids, you know how this goes. It was dark already. And we were in a new subdivision with some friends of ours, no street lights. There was a creek in the back, a crick, if you want to call it that, a crick in the back. And there was a dog that was barking. There were no backyard fences in the community. It was brand new, no backyard fences. They were kind of blending together. And there was this really mean dog that was barking. And there was a child abduction that had happened just a couple weeks before. So just to kind of set the scene, as our kids are moving out, we're counting heads. Parents, you know this. We've got 5. 1, 2, 3, 4. We're 5. And our 5th that we were looking for has blonde hair. So in a family of dark hairs, except for my wife, the blonde hair just sticks out. So I, and you know that feeling like in your heart, like, ooh, like, where's that child? So he's probably in the van. So I run out to the van, check, count kids in the van. No, there's four. So I go through the house. And, you know, by this time, I mean, our kids are tired. Dad, they want, Daddy, we want to go home. We're sleepy. You know, and some of them were hungry. Can we get some food? We want food. Okay, wait, I got to find your brother. No, we want food. No, I got to find your brother first. So I go into the home, and you know, you don't want to be inappropriate in somebody's home, and I've never done this before. I just started saying, Jordan, 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 it's time to go home, Jordan. And I started getting a little, I went all through the house, all the bedrooms, look under all the beds, all the closets, calling his name. And so I just determined I was going to go back through the house a little bit louder, because right now I'm starting to freak out a little bit. So I start going through, Jordan, you know, I'm in their house, and they come in like, what's going on? Like, I don't know where Jordan's at right now. And there were some families there, so they got the gravity of it. They all started to get concerned. And so we start going through the house, and I'm shouting almost at the top of my lungs, which I don't know if that would have helped, because I think it probably would have scared him if he had heard it. Jordan, you know, where are you? Daddy love you. I really do. You better get out here right now so I can show you. I was starting to lose it. And about 5 minutes goes by, 10 minutes goes by, and every catastrophe thinking starts going through my mind. The person that abducted the children, the dog that's barking out, did he go near that dog, that Rottweiler? There's a creek in the back. Everything is pitch black. So I decide I'm just about to call 911. But what we're going to do is we're going to go run up and down the street looking for Jordan. He couldn't have gone far. So we're going to go back to the creek, and we're going to shout, his, you know, shout Jordan. Again, the initial thought was, what are the neighbors going to think? I mean, it's like 9:30 at night. But then that thought quickly goes, because my son is lost. And so kids want food. What are people going to think about me? What are the neighbors going to think? And here's what I learned in this moment. When somebody you love is lost, it doesn't matter what everybody else wants. It doesn't matter what you look like. And it does not matter what people think about you in the moment. You do whatever you got to do in order to find that last one. And I've never forgotten that. And I feel like that gives us a little picture into the heart of the God that loves us and created us. If you want to know what Jesus is all about, he said, I am on a mission. The Son of Man has come to seek and save the lost. The lost husband, the lost father, the lost mother, wife, the lost son, the lost student, the lost business entrepreneur, the person that is lost, 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 which is all of us. That's why he came for you and I. Oh, yeah, I forgot to tell you this, the end of the story, just so you know. We still have 5 kids, okay? He shows up, no joke, he shows up at the top of the stairs. It was a 2-story home, and he's got this, you know. And at that moment, I didn't know if I wanted to hug him or if I wanted to hug him. But and everybody lost at that moment. There's just the emotional relief of finding somebody that was lost. We just began to cry. Obviously, we were just thrilled that our son was there, because he had found an Easter candy under the bed. And because he's normally not allowed to eat too much candy, and he had found too much candy, he decided that he would eat it in the privacy underneath the bed. And then he also had the thought, he's a prankster, oh, this will be a good joke to play on Dad. Yeah, yeah. So I'm going to die about 5 years earlier because of that joke. Anyway, but I think in it, we get to see a little bit of what God has called us into as his followers. This is his heart for us. And that word lost, it's not an offensive word. That word lost, I feel like that's a really appropriate description of what it means to be away from home, what it means to be at unrest, what it means to lack peace, and what it means to be at that for a long time. It describes that feeling that all of us get at certain places in our time. You ever feel it? You just get it in your gut when you realize, when you recognize that the way I thought would get me to where I wanted to go, or that way I thought was going to lead me to the place of fulfillment or peace or whatever, it's not getting me there. Not only is it not getting me there, I don't even know how to go back to that last place where I felt safe or peaceful again. I don't even know how to get back there. It's that sense of being lost. It's not a word of condemnation. It's not a word of, you know, just categorizing, putting somebody there. It's a word of compassion. Jesus looks at his people and he goes, man, my people are lost. It's a word that describes what life is like when we're out of relationship with the God that loves us. That's really what it is. All of us feel that at one point or another, just feel like we're missing something. I think after this period of COVID, there's a lot of different things we try and fill that thing with, and it fills it for a little while. So some of us have traveled. I've traveled and have gotten a sense of relief, or we've done certain things, entertained ourselves, whatever it might be, to get a little bit of relief. But there's nothing that can satisfy that sense of lostness, because that sense of lostness is there because we're out of relationship with the God who loves us. And so we've been in a series right now, families, for those of you joining us for the first time, we've been talking about the church and two ancient rhythms of the church. Jesus said this, I have a strategy for the lostness that's in the world. My strategy is to build a church, and the gates of Hades, even the gates of the dead, will not prevail against this church that I'm building. And there are two ancient rhythms in this church that Jesus is building. The two ancient rhythms are they gather together and then they scatter together. We gather together around Jesus, and we've been talking about that the last couple of weeks, and then we scatter together to go to serve the world and reach people who are lost, and to let them know that there is a God who loves them, and there is a God who wants so much for them to be in relationship with him, and there's a God who wants so much for them to be fulfilled where there's a sense of lostness. And there are three relationships that we build as followers of Christ. If you've never been to church or it's been a while, this is going to be really helpful. There's a relationship with Jesus himself. That's the reason why we're here. There's a relationship with the church community. Those are other people who follow Christ. And then there's a relationship with the world that we live in. It's the community that we live in. And I want to talk about that today, because Jesus invites us to join him on this search and rescue mission. He invites us to come and to partner with him to help reach people who are lost and introduce them to the God that loves them and satisfies that sense of lostness. And so this is the invitation that we've been given. And there is this story, this moment, and we're going to talk about two of them. They're in the same book. It's called the Book of Mark. It's in the New Testament. It's in the place in the Bible that talks about Jesus' life. It goes Matthew, Mark, and then Luke and John. So this is the second book. And in this book, there is this interaction that Jesus has, and it talks about a particular reputation that Jesus had. And Jesus' reputation helps us understand what God values the most and where following Christ will lead us. So this is really important. So if you have your Bibles this morning, you can open up. If you don't, we're going to put the scripture on the screen. I love this interaction. Jesus is, once again, he's beside this lake, the Lake Sea of Galilee, and he's teaching. There was a large crowd that came to him, and then he began to teach them. And as he walked along, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, Levi also known as Matthew. So Levi and Matthew, same, one and the same. Levi, the son of, and he was sitting at a tax collector's booth. And Jesus said to him, follow me. And he did. And Jesus told him, and Levi got up and he followed him. And while Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, so pretty quickly thereafter, Jesus has dinner at Levi's house, and many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him. And I'm going to move over here. And many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. And when the teachers of the law, who were the Pharisees, saw him eating, there's a lot of eating going on, with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? So the reason why that question made so much sense to them is because in their culture, tax collectors were people who were not appreciated. In fact, they were considered enemies of the Jewish people. And the reason why they were is because Rome, who was the governing principality or the governing governors, had other people that they enlisted to work for them to extract taxes from their people. Oftentimes, they would take not only the taxes that were owed, but they would take just a little bit more. They would skim off the top to make more money for themselves. So tax collectors were considered agents of Rome who were enemies of the Jewish people. And here's Matthew, this guy who works for Rome. He is not well looked upon. And Jesus walks up to him. And Jesus says, I know that nobody else feels like you should be in this community, but I see you. I see you. And I know you feel like you don't have a part and you're not welcome here, but as far as I'm concerned, come, follow me. You're welcome here. Now, he was probably taxing, because he was by the Sea of Galilee, he was probably taxing fishermen. And some of his other followers were fishermen. And he was also probably considered a traitor to the state. And some of his followers were also zealots of the state. And so could you imagine those guys going like, geez, what are you doing? Why are you messing up a good thing? Don't invite him. He doesn't belong here. He's not welcome here. He's not welcome in the community. Why would you welcome him here? And Jesus does the extraordinary thing. He invites somebody who's not welcome in the Jewish community to be a part of their community. And immediately he gets up. Now, it gets even worse. Matthew, I guess, goes and says, hey, Jesus, I got some friends that I want to introduce to you. And so he calls together his tax collector friends and sinners. Now, that word sinners is ambiguous. It can mean a lot of different things. In this case, it probably means people who were of a pagan background. These were not like tax collectors knew the history of Jerusalem and Judaism. But they worked for the state. So they were people who were not welcome in the community. These were people who were not familiar with the history of Jerusalem or Judaism. They were probably pagans. They worshipped idols. They were just excluded from the kingdom. They just didn't belong in the community. So he has this party with people who are not welcome and people who do not belong. And the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, and that's the person that goes, I'm in church every Sunday. I mean, these weren't necessarily bad guys. These were people who were very zealous for God guys, so much so that they couldn't believe having people who were not the people who belonged and the people who believed like them and the people who didn't know like them in their community. So when they look at this, they're like, what is he doing as a representative of God, including all of these people? And so they ask this question. This is the question they ask. And this question is shocking because it shows us really what God values. And it shows us where following God's going to lead us. He says, on hearing this, is what Jesus said to them. It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. And so that makes total sense. They're all like, oh, okay, I get it. Right? When you get sick, you go to a doctor. If you're healthy, you don't necessarily go to a doctor. And so they're all like, that makes sense. But what Jesus is about to say, it doesn't make sense to them. It is shocking to them. And I think in our world, it's still shocking. It's the reason why some people don't come to church. It's the reason why some of us maybe haven't been to church in a long time because we just didn't feel like we were supposed to be there. So Jesus says to them, I've not come to call the righteous or the good, but sinners. The first one made total sense, but this one, this doesn't make sense. I've not come. So who did he come to call? He came to call sinners. He came to call people like me. And people Jesus said, I didn't come to call people who think they don't need me. They don't need God. I come to call people who would be open-hearted enough. And I just want to invite you to open your heart. I think sometimes when we come to church, we're trying to protect ourselves from somebody finding out about us or from the feeling. I know there's that feeling sometimes. I don't know if I should be here. I just want to invite you to open up your heart, not to me, but to a God who loves you. And to a God who welcomes those who feel like they don't belong. And who welcomes those who have not been welcomed. It's so different. He welcomes sinners. You know what this tells me about God? This tells me especially about Jesus, that he doesn't draw away, he doesn't shun, he doesn't move away from us because of our sinfulness. It's actually because of our sinfulness that he came. That's why he comes near to our lives. Yeah, I don't know if you ever had a bad day. And when I say bad day, it means like I yelled at the kids, I kicked the dog, I said some things at work that I shouldn't have said. You know, man, I've been thinking some bad stuff. And we go, surely God at this point, he's far away from me. You know what this actually tells us? That when we're like that, whether I follow Christ or not, God doesn't move away from us in those moments. He actually came for us because of those moments. And he doesn't stop coming for us because we're his children or his followers. He continues to press into our lives and draw near to us. And so this is why Jesus says, I came. He came for people who made some really bad decisions. He came for people whose lives were crumbling because of things that they had done and said. He came for people who were lonely and isolated. He came for people who, after this period of COVID, have gotten involved in things and starting doing things that they never would have done before, but to cope with the isolation and everything else, and even the mental pressure and the emotional pressure, came for us. He came for lost people. He came for people who say, I don't really need God. The truth is, we do. We were created by him. We were created for him. That's not a bad thing. That's a healing thing. That makes sense of life. That makes sense of all of the pursuits that add up to nothing. Jesus said, I came for you. I came for lost people. Now, the Pharisees, they looked at all these people as total outcasts, people who didn't belong and people who were not welcome. And Jesus, he sees it totally different. He sees them as totally valuable to God. These people are precious to God. They were created in his image for his glory, for his purpose. And it doesn't matter how far they've strayed from that or how long they've been away from that. These are mine. They belong to me. And the value of something is always determined by what somebody's willing to pay for, right? It doesn't matter how much value we think it has, how much value somebody's willing to pay for something. Now, my wife, she collects memories. I'm so grateful for this aspect of her life. She collects memories of our family. And the way that she does that is by taking pictures, lots of pictures. Ever since they were little kids, videos, pictures, 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 pictures. And she stores them. She stored them on this computer. And, man, have you ever just done something that you regret for the rest of your life? I was restoring our computer, and you know when that thing comes up and says, are you sure you want to reset it? And you're like, that's what I say now. I said, yes. Can you feel the pain? She cried for days. I know, you feel so sorry. She cried for days. She was so heartbroken, and I totally understand. Those pictures, and obviously those pictures have no necessary value to you, but for her, she would have paid anything to get them back. She would. So instead, she put safeguards on all the computers, got clouds and everything else. I am not proud, and don't judge me. There was another update that came. It's not funny. I'm still. So anyway, I don't get near those pictures anymore. But she would have paid anything to salvage those pictures. This is how valuable you are to the one that created you. He sent his son, his only son, his only unique son. He came into our earth himself to die on a cross in our place to pay the price for our sins so that you could have the potential of being brought back into relationship, so that the lostness that you and I have could be filled with his foundness. That's how much he loves you and how valuable you and I are to him. As we sang that song, there's really no way for us to even understand the value of what God did for you and I. But because people are valuable to God, those who follow him live with this urgency to bring people who are far from God near to him. There is this urgency of faith. There is this urgency of love that's inside of us. And so God invites us into this. Throughout our message, I'm going to give you just a couple things. If you're going, you know what, I want to be able to do this better. I want to be able to know how to communicate this better. I'm going to give you just I'm going to call it a gospel summary. Dr. Rice Brooks, he just wrote a gospel statement. This is that gospel summary. This is that gospel statement. I don't know if you've ever been in a place before where you kind of feel like maybe God nudging you just to let somebody know how much God loves them. But you're already afraid, like, what do I say? What do I say? What do I say? Well, hey, did you know God loves you? Is a good place to start. But this gospel summary just summarizes the good news of the gospel. And I want to invite you, if you go, you know what, I want to be able to do this better, then I want to invite you to memorize this. And this is what you'd say to somebody if you're riding up an elevator, you got like 20 seconds, and they want to know, like, what's the big deal about Jesus? Well, here's the big deal about Jesus. The gospel is the good news that God became man in Jesus Christ. He lived the life that we should have lived, and then he died the death that we should have died in our place. And then 3 days later, he rose again from the dead, proving that he is the Son of God. Not just that, but offering forgiveness of sins and salvation. Salvation and forgiveness of sins to anyone who repents, who turns away from trusting in their sin to believe in him. He offers forgiveness of sins and salvation. That's good news. That's good news. As one person told me, if it ever starts sounding like bad news, we're telling them the wrong thing. That is good news right there. So can I invite you, whether you believe it or not, or whether you understand it or not, would you just mind saying it with me? Can we just repeat this? This is the good news. If you ever wondered what the gospel is, this is the good news. And I'll say a line, and would you just repeat it back? So the gospel is the good news. That God became man in Jesus Christ. He lived the life we should have lived. And then he died the death that we should have died in our place. And then 3 days later, he rose from the dead, proving that he is the Son of God and offering salvation and forgiveness of sins. And I love this word, to anyone, to lost people, like you and I, to lost people, to anyone. He offers forgiveness of sins and salvations to anyone who repents and believes in him. That's the good news. That's what Jesus has invited us to partner together with him to take into all the world. To help lost people come into relationship with the living God. And I want to look at an interaction as we just kind of wind down really practically to discover, and I think in this interaction, three different things that we can do if we really want to bring people to Jesus. These are three different things that we can do. And so this is the same chapter. Earlier in the chapter, this is maybe something that Matthew heard about or he witnessed. A few days later, after Jesus entered Capernaum, the people had heard that he had come, and they gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word of God to them. So Jesus is in his hometown, and he's teaching people. People are so excited to hear it that people have gathered from all around. It's really interesting, though, that whenever Jesus taught in his hometown, because he was so familiar, I mean, everybody knew him. I mean, that's Mary's son, right? Wasn't he that carpenter guy? I mean, my kid grew up with him. Like, they played Little League together. Go, Honolulu World Series Championship today, right? Okay, sorry, distracting myself. Isn't that Jesus? I mean, what's he doing? And there wasn't a big expectation that Jesus could do anything. So oftentimes, Jesus would be teaching, and they would love hearing it, But there was no faith or expectation, so Jesus wasn't able to do any miracles because somehow, and I'm not sure how this exactly works, but God responds to our faith. When there's an expectation, God responds to it, our expectation. And so here's what happens. Some men carried, bringing a paralyzed man to him. They carried a paralyzed man carried by all four of them. And since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and lowered the man on a mat right in front of him. Now, just picture this in your mind real quick. Jesus is teaching, crowded room, can't get in, and these guys began somehow feeling like it was an okay thing to dig through his roof. You had a meeting at your house, for whatever reason, somebody goes, I got to get in there so much because Jesus is here, and I believe that if I get my friend there, he will do something. And they start digging through your roof. You go, good job. You go, what in the world are you doing? And so they're digging through. But Jesus, he sees something because Jesus sees differently than everybody else sees. When he saw Matthew, he didn't see the outcast that everybody else saw. He saw the real Matthew. That is somebody that I love, that I've created in my image for my purpose and my glory. That is somebody for whom I've given my son to die on a cross, to pay the price for his sins. That's how much value he has. And Jesus sees something in this moment that nobody else is seeing. He sees their faith. They believe Jesus is here and Jesus can do something for their friend. So they want to get their friend before Jesus no matter what. And so they bring their friend, they lower him to him, and then Jesus says the most unexpected thing. He says, your sins are forgiven. And that's really not, you know, I imagine the guy on the mat was going, that's not why I'm here. I mean, great. But that's not why I'm here. And in this moment, Jesus is stepping in. He's basically saying that I have the authority that only God has to be able to forgive sins. And that is your bigger need. I know your need, you feel like, is you need to be healed from your paralysis. But you need to be healed from your lostness is really what you need. And you just don't realize it yet. And this is something that only God, as you know him, has been able to do. But this is something that I, because I'm God, have the authority to do. So then he goes on, he says this, what's easier for me to say, your sins are forgiven, or rise and be healed? And they all go, well, of course, it's easier for you to say your sins are forgiven. Anybody can say that. And so Jesus says, okay, so you know that I have the authority to take care of a deeper need, your lostness, rise and be healed. And God heals him physically, Jesus heals him physically, and then that validates his authority to be able to issue forgiveness. And so in this story, there are three things, and I'll just give them to you real quick, and you can look at them. If you have your notes this morning, you can just look at them in your notes. If we want to bring people to Jesus, like in this story, we have to be willing to bear some burdens, take some risks, and extend some hospitality. Bear some burdens. Some men, they came bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by all four of them. Carried by all four. I don't know if you ever tried to carry somebody who's like playing dead weight. This is the guy who's been paralyzed, an adult. It takes four of them. It takes a small group, which is one of the reasons why we gather together in smaller communities called small groups. It takes a small group to help their friend who is paralyzed and has need to bring this person with need to Jesus. They believe that Jesus is here, and even though nothing else can help him, Jesus can help him, because wherever Jesus is present, miracles take place. We're tempted in our culture, in our world. I don't know why we do this. We look for miracles in everything, and Jesus is typically the last thing that we look to for a miracle. And these guys knew that if I get him before Jesus, that a miracle will take place. So they bear the burden together of getting him there. What would it look like for you to bear the burden in somebody's life? I'm not just saying tell them about Jesus. I'm talking about show them about Jesus. Most of the time, unfortunately, if you're a follower of Christ, we try and tell people without showing them. And showing them opens up the way for us to tell people about them. Like my friend who had a friend who was going through alcohol detox. And he spent the week with him. He lived with him. And as he was going through, I don't know if you've ever been through somebody who's going through a drug or alcohol detox, but there's a lot of things that are coming up and that are happening in that moment. And there was a lot of anger and aggression that was coming out of him. And for that whole week, he bore the burden of his anger and aggression just to be with him, just to love him that way. Maybe in your world, there's a burden to bear. One of the burdens to bear is prayer. I have a grandmother that prayed for me for 20 years before I came to know Jesus. She was praying for me for 20 years. In the moments where I totally rejected her because she would tell me about Jesus, maybe you have somebody like this in your life. Thank God for praying moms. She would pray and pray and pray. And when I said, no, forget that, I'm just going to do my own thing, and then I did my own thing and suffered the consequences of doing my own thing, she prayed and she prayed and she bore the burden of it. She bore the burden of my rejection. She bore the burden of my wandering. She bore the burden of just watching me and continuing to pray and to pray and to pray. Until one day when God said, come, follow me. She bore the burden. We bear the burden. We go to people's hospital beds and we bear the burden of being there. We bear the burden, I think, in our culture and our world. One of the biggest burdens we need to bear is the burden of listening to somebody else like you did. Listen to the heart of somebody else like Clifton. I'm pointing to Clifton. Sorry, everybody. Like Clifton did. And bear the burden of doing the second thing, taking the risk. Taking the risk of potentially being rejected to let somebody who needs to hear it know that there's a God who cares about them, loves them, and sees them. And you did that. You took a risk being rejected. You took a risk of that awkwardness. Because it is, it's awkward. The only thing that can move us past that awkward space and make any of that worthwhile is the motivation of love. Love is the only thing that can get us to take the risk that we need to take in order to share the good news with people. Because we have to go beyond just even living it to actually speaking it. I'm here today because somebody shared the good news with me. A woman on my college campus risked being rejected by me. And I actually did reject her the first time. She came back again, shared it with me again, and risked being misperceived and risked being misunderstood and risked that awkward conversation. But we've got to open up our mouths in order to take a risk, in order to bring people who need the Jesus to fill their lostness to Jesus. And so these guys, they do that. They risk it. They go, and again, how crazy is this? They begin digging through the roof where Jesus is preaching. Now, I don't know if you do this, but when I read my Bible, I think that God wants us to use our imagination because some of the things aren't detailed. But can you imagine this scenario? If you ever feel foolish doing something, can you ever imagine this scenario? They were so determined to get their friend before Jesus, they were not going to let an obstacle stand in the way. They had to take a risk. And I don't know how it's going down, but a room is crowded and Jesus is preaching, and all of a sudden, like, stuff is falling. And this might have been Jesus' house. In all likelihood, it actually was. This is not just somebody else's house. Somebody else's house, you can kind of go like, hey, is the owner going to do something about this? This is my house. Particles are falling, and somebody is being lowered before Jesus. And Jesus doesn't shut it down. He goes, I see your faith. You believe that I can do something for your paralyzed friend. That's why you took that risk. And when we believe that Jesus can do something for our friends who are paralyzed in lostness, who are paralyzed in their sin, then we too, we're willing to take a risk. Many risks. So let me ask you this. Is there a risk in your life that Jesus is maybe asking you to take? Well, Greg, what would that be? I don't know. Maybe it's just a text message to let somebody know that you were thinking about them, that you're praying for them. Or maybe as you go into work, it's just offering somebody an invitation to come to your small group. Or maybe just this third thing, extend some hospitality to somebody. So one of the fascinating things about Jesus is it seems like he ate and drank a lot. And actually, it doesn't even seem like it. It's recorded that he did. In fact, the whole issue here that they have with him is his eating. So they say this to him. Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners. Now, in the culture of their world, eating was something very specific. Eating was an invitation to friendship. It was an invitation to intimacy. And so as you look through the scriptures, Jesus, he eats and he drinks a lot. So much so, he had two primary, you know, reputations. Number one, his primary reputation was that he was a friend of people who didn't belong and who weren't welcome. He was a friend of sinners. But his other reputation was he was a glutton and a drunkard. Jesus, you're eating and drinking with people. In fact, if you go through the book of Luke, and for me, I think a better question is, why didn't the Pharisees and the scribes eat with people who weren't like them? It's the same reason why sometimes we don't eat with people who aren't like us. Because we're afraid. They don't believe like us. They don't think like us. It's scary. Jesus moves beyond fear to create a space where people feel welcome. I mean, you think about the people that followed him. They were the craziest bunch of people. I mean, peasants, wealthy, nationalists, people who worked for the state. They were all kind of people. Women who in that culture, they weren't included in stuff like this. Those were the kind of people that followed Jesus. They didn't get along because they had all similar demographic or cultural background. They got along because Jesus created this space where they were welcome and they were invited to be a part. And one of the ways that he did it was by eating with people. So if you go through the book of Luke, Jesus eats with tax collectors and sinners in Luke 5 and Luke 7. Jesus is anointed in the home of a Pharisee while they're eating a meal. Jesus in Luke 9 feeds 5,000. Jesus eats in the home of Mary and Martha in Luke 10. In Luke 11, Jesus condemns the Pharisee and teachers over a meal. Jesus invites himself to a guy's house for dinner. His name is Zacchaeus. Jesus invites himself. The last account of the meal he took was Last Supper. Jesus eats Last Supper. It actually didn't finish. After he died and rose again, Jesus eats a meal with two guys as they're traveling on the road to what's called Damascus. They don't even recognize Jesus. Jesus eats with them. And in the moment where he eats with them and they break bread together, that's when their eyes are opened up and they actually begin to see who he is. There's something powerful about extending not just a meal, but hospitality. Especially to those who are not like us. It's so much easier to stay in our Christian safe bubbles, and we go to different activities where there's other Christians, and we go to different things where there's other followers of Christ. But Jesus says, I want you to come and follow me into my example of eating with people who aren't welcome and who don't belong, and offering them welcome. It's one of the reasons why we do say around here, everyone's welcome. Because the truth is, nobody's perfect. And with God, anything is possible. Worship team, come and join me this morning. And so Jesus, this is the power of a meal. I have a friend who a couple of weeks ago called me really urgently. She's a friend of my wife's, and she said, I have this friend who is open. I think he's open, but he needs somebody that he just can ask questions to and talk to about Jesus. Would you be willing to meet with him? Would you be willing to give him a call and meet with him? I said, most definitely. There was an urgency of faith. Her urgency is not if he comes and talks to me, but if I can get him in an environment where he understands who Jesus is, Jesus can do something in his life. Because he needs it just like I need it and you need it. We all need it. We all experience that sense of lostness at one point or another. So you know what I did, of course, right? I said, yeah, let me call him and grab lunch with him. We just take him to lunch so that I can hear him, so that I can tell him about this Jesus that loves him. Bear some burdens, take some risks, then extend some hospitality. You know what? One of the best things you could probably do just leaving here today is giving somebody a call or text and just letting them know that you see them. Because after this long period of COVID, there are a lot of people who feel right now invisible, and they have no idea where to go with that. After this long period of COVID, there are a lot of people who are struggling with lostness. It doesn't mean necessarily that they're even alone. They just feel, even in the midst of being around other people, they feel lost. How many of you, anybody, be honest enough to say, over this last 2.5 year period, especially now, sometimes I just feel like lost a little bit. Anybody? I have. And I've needed somebody just to listen to me and let me know I see you, and I'm going to remind you, there's a God who sees you. Yeah, there's a God who sees you. So, as together we're gonna memorize, I want to invite you to memorize that gospel statement. I also want to ask you to do this. Can you think of maybe two or three people in your life that you can pray for and begin saying, God, I want you to meet my friends. And just with an urgency, begin to pray for them, trusting that God can do something that you can't do. And then just be willing to bear some burdens, and to take some risks, and then to extend some hospitality. See what God does. Like he did with that paralyzed man. God wants to do something that only Jesus can do. He's called us to go and seek and save the lost with him. We get to be a part of this incredible mission with him. It's why we're at church right here, right next to the University of Hawaii, and in this community, because I believe God wants to use us in that way. So you pray with me this morning. God, we thank you, Lord, that in the midst of our lostness, Lord, you didn't reject us, you didn't turn away. Lord, none of us really should be included. We don't belong. None of us should be welcomed. But God, you did it anyway. You welcomed us. You included us. And God, you made a place where we could belong. And so, Lord, we're grateful today. And I pray that you would stir in our heart a fresh passion, Lord. Fresh passion for people who are lost. For our coworkers that are lost. Lord, for the people that we go to school with that are lost. Lord, for even people in our own family, it's our children, it's our spouses, Lord, that are lost. Lord, you so badly want to fill their lostness, to forgive their sin, to bring salvation to their life. So, Lord, I pray that you would give us something that we don't have on our own. You would give us a fresh passion for that. Lord, and I pray for us in here who are lost this morning. We came in here, and maybe today you're realizing, I need Jesus. I don't know what that means, but I need to know this love that this guy's been talking about. I need to know the love of somebody who would send his son to demonstrate how much he loves me by dying on a cross to pay the price for my sins. This morning, if that's you, you say, you know what, I'm ready to follow Jesus. I want him to fill the lostness of my life with his presence. Can you just lift your hand right now? I want to pray for you, pray with you. Amen. 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 If that's you this morning and you're going, I just want Jesus to fill my life with his presence. Forgive me of my sin. Just say this simple prayer with me. It's not magical. It's just an honest prayer of your heart. God, thank you. Thank you for sending Jesus. Jesus, thank you for giving your life. I pray you would forgive me of my sin. And I pray that you would receive me into your family. Lord, I give you all of my life because you gave me all of your life. Fill that place in my heart that feels lost with your spirit and your presence so that I can follow you now all the days of my life, and I can help other lost people come to you as well. In Jesus' powerful name, amen. 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 Can we just celebrate for those who just prayed that prayer for the first time? Amen. Amen. It's a big day. Families, again, we are grateful that you are here with us today. As we go out of this place today, I want to encourage you. You go out with a great sense of purpose and mission. We have been called to partner with God to help reach those who don't know him and to bring him near, just like Jesus did with us. Have a great week. We want to invite our families to stick around for some time afterwards in the pavilion. We're going to present each of the families that have dedicated their children. We're going to pray for the children and just have a special time of mingling together as families. So that's going to happen right outside at our pavilion there. And have a great week. We will see you in small group, and we will see you right back here next Sunday. God bless you this morning.